This is ThinkTech Hawaii. Community matters here.
Guys, and we're back live here in ThinkTech Studios. I'm your host, the Prince of Investing, coming to you guys live all the way from Denver. I know it's kind of crazy, right? Yes, I'm in Denver, Colorado, but we're shooting live in Honolulu, Hawaii. So, guys, don't forget to hit the like, subscribe, comment, and share button, all that other great stuff. Follow us on ThinkTech Hawaii, or you can follow us right here on the Prince of Investing / the Investor Show. But as always, guys, I don't have a lot of time, and I definitely know you guys don't have a lot of time, so we're going to jump straight into it. Now, one of the things I want to mention today, as you guys see in the description box, we're going to be talking about, should I buy Bitcoin? Because as we all know, Bitcoin has been going crazy, especially last week when I thought of this topic. It was at its all-time high. It hit its all-time high on about 19, 20,000 or something like that per coin. Then 6 days later, it hit its, not an all-time low, but it had like a 40%, 50% drop where it flashed down to $10,000 and it went up to $14,000. And the last time I looked at it today, it was at around about $16,000, $14,000, $15,000, $16,000. So very volatile. And when I say volatile, I mean by it goes up and down. Now, the thing to think about that is when you are looking at a stock like that, not a stock, but a commodity or an asset class like that that is very volatile. Now, some people say when you look at it, that's very volatile, it may bring in a lot of opportunities. True. But another thing you may think about is Bitcoin is up 1,900% so far this year. That's why you see it all over the press. That's why you have been getting the news and all that stuff like that. But on this topic, what I'm going to do, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to discuss the question of should I buy Bitcoin? When would I buy Bitcoin? And I'm going to talk about the pros and the cons. That's my personal opinion. Now, let me throw a disclaimer out here. I'm not some Bitcoin mining expert from around the globe and things like that to where I know exactly what I want. It's kind of ironic. The people that are crazy about Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies now, that they were the same people that was crazy about marijuana stocks about 6 months ago. They don't talk about marijuana stocks anymore, but now it seems to be the new gold rush. Now, 6-7 months ago, marijuana was a gold rush. So when you're investing, you have to keep a level head and not jump off into the new hot thing and stay steady. Now, one of the things I want to speak on is I'm going to talk about what would have to happen before I would buy Bitcoin or any cryptocurrency. Because as of right now, I hold no direct assets into a direct cryptocurrency, and I will discuss why. Now, the first thing is, should I buy it? I look at it and I say, hey, people, hey, should I buy this? Should I invest into this? Things like that. Using it as a long-term investment, no. I will say if you're someone who's high risk, short term, and you, it pretty much has to be your throwaway money or your lottery ticket money. Nothing more than 10% of what your whole asset class is. If you got $100, no more than $10 thrown away into a high risk, short term, very high risk. Because theoretically, Bitcoin today is $16,000, it could easily be $40,000. By next week or by the summer, easy, right? Or it could be zero. Same thing. Think about it. You know, you lose 50%, then back up 30% just that fast in a week's time frame. Very volatile. So something that is very high risk. If you're very high risk, money that you plan on throwing away that you can lose, I would say yes. I would probably look into Bitcoin. Here's why. One is we always know new things come along in society. What I do like about cryptocurrencies and Bitcoin, the reason why I say Bitcoin, because it was the first currency in 2009. Now, when I look at myself, when I look at society, how we spend money, it has changed over time. So, for prime example, the way we buy things and consume things have changed. First thing being is when look at the way we use money. I could send you money right now just with your email address. You can put away your cash, you can put away your credit card, go out, well, not necessarily your credit card, but you can put away your cash, take your dollars, leave them at home, and you can go out and buy gas, and you can go out and you can go shopping, have a nice dinner. You can pretty much essentially live without cash these days. Whereas you're talking about 50 years ago, that would probably been impossible. I'm 33 years old now. When I was younger, my parents mostly used checks, you know, handwritten checks. Now you guys probably don't know what it is, but a lot of people used to use checks. Now you don't see people use checks that much no more. Now you see people use plastic. So with people using plastic, credit cards, what I mean by that, times have changed. People was using people was using checks, then they went to credit cards. Now it's to where I can send money across the globe just via an email address, or you can send me money just with my email address. So this paper form of money, I don't see it being around too much longer in the future because it's just technology. We evolve. We're humans. That's what we do. And I can see us evolving into a digital currency. That's what half of us are right now. 90%, how often do you go to the bank? Everything you can drive and go into the drive-through, you pretty much can do with a machine or at home. So most people will only go to the bank for very few rare occasions. So that's one thing. I do see us moving into a digital currency. How does that form into something being good? As we know, cryptocurrencies is a digital currency. So when I look at that being a digital currency, I start to realize and say, hey, well, the world is kind of evolving into a form of digital currency. Now, I'm not saying that it's Bitcoin. I'm not saying it's Litecoin, Ethereum, or whatever, but I can see us using a digital currency. I don't see us in the future walking up to some big refrigerator, big blocky ATM drawing out cash. That's not where I see us going in the future. So that's one thing. I do see us moving into a digital currency, so hey, that is a good thing for me. Another good thing is the technology that is behind cryptocurrency. Something I hear people get confused sometimes. The difference between blockchain and Bitcoin. There is a difference. Bitcoin is the currency that utilizes blockchain. Blockchain is the technology. Now, blockchain, I'm very convinced into blockchain that is revolutionary, that is going to eliminate a lot of jobs. It is a way of the future. What is blockchain? I give you a very elementary way of thinking of blockchain. Blockchain is like an automatic ledger. Right, it's an automatic ledger of buy and sell, things like that. Whereas you used to have a group of people or entity to say, hey, this person bought this, this person sold this, and make sure that it was the right thing or whatnot. The blockchain pretty much replaces all of that. It's a good buy and sell that goes back and forth. Right. So with that being said, I'm a firm believer in things like accounting, things like finance, things like in government, small business or large business could utilize blockchain and eliminate a lot of people to document things, right? So I'm a big believer into blockchain. If I knew how to invest into blockchain directly, I would do it, right? I believe into that concept because hearing many high-level company CEOs and executives think about how much money they spend on having a group of people or entity keep track of what we buy and sell. For prime example, when you go swipe your card, your Visa, MasterCard at Starbucks, and it goes to your bank account and it takes out the money and leaves a transaction, you know, it takes out the money, puts the money in Starbucks, takes out your Bank of America account, who's doing all that back and forth information? Who's doing all that backdoor information? That is not the bank. That's what I used to think. I was, oh, well, the bank handles all that. No. Usually the bank hires out a third-party entity that takes care of that for them. So with that being said, I can see blockchain, that's a billion-dollar industry that those third-party companies, they are a billion-dollar industry that handles, places all these financial institutions' backdoor work. I can see blockchain technology replacing those particular people. Those are the good things. Now, going off into Bitcoin, the reason why Bitcoin became the big thing about Bitcoin was that it removes the middleman. With our current currency, we have the Federal Reserves. The Federal Reserves can print money. The Federal Reserves can draw back on money, right? You know, they're the ones that control the interest rates on money and things like that or whatnot, whatever the case may be. The Federal Reserve, with blockchain, there is no middleman. I'm not with blockchain, but with cryptocurrency, there is no middleman. There's just Bitcoin. So when I go to think about that, that's one of the things that I like about it. Now, with every positive, It is a negative, right? I told you guys a good thing. I'm going to tell you things I don't like about Bitcoin. And I'm going to get into what's going to need to happen for me to invest or to buy any Bitcoin or cryptocurrency or whatever. The first thing, what if Bitcoin gets hacked? What if it gets hacked? What if somebody, right now they say, oh, it's unhackable. But come on, everybody knows that, but if you don't know, let me educate you and let you know, anything that a man creates, a human, because women out there that create awesome stuff too, anything that a human creates, another human can uncreate or break it or hack it. That's just a point blank system. Now, granted, it's great cryptology and great technology, whatever the case may be, you know, it's using quadrillion and all these other big fancy terms out there. It's so far advanced, or whatever the case may be. It was the same thing that we said about computers. Computers used to be this big, bulky, expensive thing that only the government could buy. Now, computers have been reduced to this. A phone, a cell phone that can be carried around, compact, that even my six-year-old son could use, right? That's just called evolution. You evolve. We figure things out. That's what humans do. So right now, yes, it is far-fetched technology, but I guarantee you somebody right now is trying to figure out a way to hack it. Why would someone try to figure out a way to hack it? Because wherever there's money, there's motive. Why would somebody break into the bank? Why would somebody hack into all these different websites? Because there's money. Money there. Look at the market capitalization, but it's 270-something billion, a million, or whatever the case may be. Don't quote me on that. But it's a large market capitalization. I think it's billion. But you have a large market capitalization, almost positive that it's billion. We have a large market capitalization like that. That's enough motive right there. So what if it is hacked? What if someone hacks into the system and figures out something, does something funky with it? What's going to happen to the value of my cryptocurrency? I'm going to lead you to the next question. That leads me to the next question. Regulation. Who's regulating this market? It's the reason why we had the SEC that regulates our U.S. stock market. Before a stock is listed, it has to go through the SEC. In order to stay listed, it has to go through SEC streamless process to make sure you're not taking people's money, all that great stuff like that. What happens, will the SEC regulate it? In my belief system, I think eventually they will. Because right now, if you go into Coinbase, buy a bunch of Bitcoin, make a bunch of money, and transaction into the IRS, how can the IRS track it? They can't track it. They don't know what's going to happen, right? So is it regulated? It's an unregulated black market, right? So we have an unregulated black market. If the SEC gets its hands involved, the federal government gets its hands involved, what's going to happen to the value of my cryptocurrency? Because wouldn't that defeat the purpose of having a cryptocurrency if the government has its hands in it? Right? If the SEC gets saying, hey, you can do this, you can do that, and put all these regulations on it, what's going to happen to the value? That's my second concern. Another concern, looking at the competition, there are thousands of cryptocurrencies. You heard of Bitcoin, you hear Litecoin, you hear Ethereum, you hear Razzle, Dazzle, and I'm not even speaking at probably the 100 that was created today. I know people that are buying Bitcoin right now. So when I look at this, when I look at people that are buying, creating their own cryptocurrencies. If someone can go out and mimic what I'm doing and create what I'm doing, what's the real value of what I have? Right? So it's thousands of them out there. How can I possibly pick the right one right now? It's like picking the needle out of a haystack. The only one I would trust, like the Jordan Buffett, the Wolf of Wall Street, said when he came onto the show about a month or so ago, he was like, the only cryptocurrency I would trust right now is Bitcoin, because it was the first, and since that it's the first, it's probably the most reliable. But there literally are like thousands of cryptocurrencies out there. How can I pick the right cryptocurrency at this point? What's the difference between Litecoin, Ethereum, Ripple, Razzle, Dazzle, whatever the case may be. I can't even name them all. There's so many out there. So right now, when you're picking out Bitcoin, you're saying that you're smart enough and you have the edge over everybody else that's in the marketplace. Do I feel like I have an edge to pick Bitcoin over other currencies? No. That's another thing. Gold versus Bitcoin. When I look at gold, people say, hey, well, you know, the dollar's a fiat currency. It's correct. The dollar's not backed by anything. That's correct. The only thing that backs the dollar is the U.S. government. The U.S. government says, hey, I will honor this promissory note. And since the U.S. government has a pretty good high credit rating, people trust the U.S. government. They use the dollar. If I saw a dollar on the road today, I know I can go buy a particular thing, right? So I can go buy goods or services, essentially. But right now with Bitcoin, some people say it's supposed to be a currency. And by it being a currency, you see ATMs pop up all over the globe. You have ATMs. You got different places that are accepting Bitcoin. But the thing is, just because what makes it trade for $16,000 a day is not because that's the raw value of it. It's just that that's the price someone is willing to pay. Just because something is going up doesn't mean that it's the raw value, right? And the other piece I want to backtrack and go into the SEC, since you're in an unregulated market, you can have insider trading, market manipulation. What is insider trading? What is market manipulation? How can you do something like that? It's like this, right? I take me and my buddy, John, let's say for example, me and my buddy John, I sell him my cryptocurrencies for $10. He buys it for $10. Now, the last price that's going across the wire is $10 sold to John. So now my currency is worth $10. I buy it back from him for $15. Now, the person who's on the outside, they look at it, they're like, wow, you know, this new thing that Prince Dykes created has a lot of value. Because look, it was at $10, now it's going back to $5. Now John buys it back from me for $30. Now, people are like, whoa, it's going from $10 to $30. That's a 300% jump. That is crazy, right? But really, it could be two people manipulating the market. You don't think that happens, you're crazy. That's why they have regulators involved inside the U.S. stock market, and people still get away with it and do it. So in an unregulated market, what do you think they're doing? Everywhere you have money, you have some type of manipulation, or you have some type of corruption. That's just the case. There's nothing against, hey, Bitcoin. That's just everywhere you go. You find money, you find some form of corruption. That's just the second thing. But I don't want to get back off. I don't want to lose track of what I was saying. I wanted to speak about the when you look at the current state of gold, which is a commodity. You know, guy made a good point. Hey, Princeton, what's the difference between gold and what's the difference between Bitcoin? And the difference is, when you say gold is a commodity, Bitcoin is supposed to be a currency. I don't see anybody buying it to, you know, hey, I want to get these coins so I can go buy dinner tonight. Most people are treating it like a commodity. And you want to say it's a commodity? Great. People are just getting it and they're hurting it away, right? So when you look at that, if it is a commodity, the thing of what makes gold a commodity is a precious metal. The word precious gives it, hey, you know, I just can't go outside in my room and manufacture a piece of gold, right, that I know of, you know. So gold is a rare commodity. It's a point of gold, a metal, or whatever the case may be, that has some type of value. People use gold for a lot of things. You know, somebody just didn't pick this random stone. It was used for a lot of things back in the day before it became a currency. You have gold chips and you can melt it down and turn it into the Federal Reserve. You had a little value with it. You know, dentists was using it for teeth, science people was using it for all type of things. But it was a rare commodity. It was a stone that we decided we could do something with. Bitcoin, what is it backed by? What is giving Bitcoin its value besides someone right now is buying it for $15,000 a coin? Now, what's going to lead me into my second part. When regulators come in, what I was speaking about with the SEC, if the regulators come in, the government comes in, and the government says, hey, about this Bitcoin madness, this is what we're going to do now. We're now going to create our own Bitcoin. We're going to create our currency. If the SEC, the Fed stepped in and they regulated it, now they're regulated, that kind of defeats the purpose of having a blockchain. Or if the federal government came out with a dollar coin and said, hey, this is the accepted currency of our XYZ. We're stopping the federal government from doing that. And if they do that, what's going to happen to the price of, or what's going to happen to the value of my Bitcoin or my cryptocurrency? Those are questions I have that a lot of people can't ask. What's stopping the SEC from creating its own cryptocurrency? What's stopping the SEC from regulating the cryptocurrency market here in the U.S.? If it does market here in the U.S., what does that mean? If the SEC markets, wouldn't it completely like devalue my cryptocurrency? Right? Wouldn't it devalue my cryptocurrency? If I went ahead and just threw my money right into, if, you know, now that it's not needed, or if the government created their own, or what happened to the other thousand out there? Those are questions. Now I'm going to get into the next one. What's going to happen? What needs to happen to Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies before I will buy? Right now, I look at cryptocurrencies as a haystack. Do I believe in digital currency? Yes. Do I believe in blockchain technology? Yes. But out of the thousand cryptocurrencies out right now, how can I or you legitimately pick the right one, two, three, whatever the case may be? I don't know. But for me to do this, I heard it's coming around the corner. I heard it's about to come out. If there was an ETF, if there was a mutual fund, or whatever you want to call it, that went back and said, hey, you know what we're going to do? We're going to create an ETF that's going to, we're going to bottle all these currencies together, just like ETFs do, and you can purchase all the cryptocurrencies up on the one stop. Now, I've noticed one something out there like that, JBTC, there's some other cryptocurrencies out there, but they're not exactly what I'm looking for at this point. If you can bottle all the cryptocurrencies, then that's what's going to happen for me to want to buy. Because the thing about it is, when you have, why would I try to pick a needle out of the haystack when I can just pick up the whole haystack, right? Why would I, why majority of my portfolio is the S&P 500? The reason that is the S&P 500 is because it gives me 500 companies. I'm not here trying to pick an individual stock that I've never heard of, that I hope that I read a newsletter on, or a coworker told me, or a friend told me, or something that I read on a media outlet that said, hey, you should go out and buy this particular company. No, I'm using companies that are, that I know is, what you call it, the S&P 500, that's the top 500 companies in the U.S. I always use this analogy. 20 years ago, Blockbuster didn't seem like a bad investment. Now, today, yeah, it doesn't look too hot, right? Why doesn't it look too hot? Because evolution. Blockbuster didn't evolve with time. And when it tried to evolve with time, it was too late. But if I had the top 500 companies in America, I'm fine anyway. So, I don't know. Ethereum might be the next big thing. Ethereum. Bitcoin Cash could be the next big thing. Bitcoin. Whatever currency that's out there, and the ones that's being created, the next one that jumps in, or whatever. They could be the big thing. I don't know. But until that happens, I can't try to go out and pick one. So when I go back and I look at the whole situation, I spoke about it. Should you buy it? We're going to do a recap. Should you buy it? Only if it's, if you're high risk, short term, no more than 10% of what you have in your assets. When would I buy in particular? Probably when they have an ETF or mutual fund that gathers the whole industry as a whole. Just like I can go buy the real estate industry, or I can invest in the real estate industry, I can invest into the automobile industry, all retail industry, all type of things, right? So the next thing is, that's what I will buy. What are the good things? It's a digital currency. I believe the world is moving closer and closer to a digital currency, you know, just the way we are evolving. Why are we carrying back these paper dollars? And most people are accepting cards. Some of them are accepting cryptocurrencies. So I can see us moving to a digital currency. Another good thing, blockchain technology, the juggernaut, that's going to change a lot of, change the way we live in a lot of aspects. It's going to kill a lot of jobs. A lot of jobs are going to have to move, right? So blockchain technology, that's what I like about it. Now, the things I don't like about it, you have, can it be hacked? Government regulations. The thousands of coins that are out there, how do I know the government won't create its own coins? Then on top of that, another big one that I left off and originally, looking at the stock market returns. Right now, the S&P 500 is up about 20% just in 2017 alone. And last year, I want to think it went up 16%. So when you're getting 16%, 20%, that's not bad of an investment. Now, why would someone who's getting 16, 15, 20%, why would they jump off into the next hot thing just to get 1,000%? So if your portfolio is up right now to 15%, 16% or something like that, why would I try to jump off into the next or the new hot thing? Why? The reason why a lot of investors are not jumping into Bitcoin because the U.S. market is doing so well. Another thing is Bitcoin started in 2009. Bitcoin started in the bull market. How will Bitcoin act in the bear market? How will it act in the next market crash? Those are questions that I have. Right? We don't know. It may skyrocket in a market crash. It may replace gold or skyrocket. Then reverse end, it may collapse. You just never know. Those are questions that I have with Bitcoin. So with that, I give you guys, should you buy? When will I buy? Gold over Bitcoin, gold and Bitcoin, hacking it, stock market returns, government regulations, and also the thousands of competitions out there, I give you the good things. And then there's a lot of people that are Bitcoin mining. I don't want to get too far from Bitcoin mining because I know a lot of people do that to make money. Something that's not my field. I'm not 100% on that. May bring on a guest in the future to speak more about that. But, you know, hey, that's my take on it. That's my take on it. But should I buy, when I buy, the pros and the cons, and what happens for me in order to buy. I hope that helped you guys out. Hope you guys take away something from that. I'm going to go ahead and close out here. Thank you guys for tuning on. This is the Prince of Investing. I'm your host, Prince Dykes, coming to you guys each and every week here on Hawaii. Don't forget to hit the like, subscribe, comment, and share button. Check us out on YouTube, Facebook, podcasts, all of the great stuff. Until you hear me do that again or say anything like that again, I kind of messed up my clothes there a little bit. But peace, be safe, I'm out, and thank you.